Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here with me today. My name is Adam McGee, and I would like to welcome you all to my senior project. Today I'll be giving a lecture on the history of the trombone, talk about the life and works of Donald Way, and give a brief analysis over the pieces I'm going to perform today. I am a Houston area native that started playing the trombone in 2007 and began my education at Western State University in 2014. I have been a student of Dr. Vivio since 2016. Firstly, I will walk you through an in-depth, a brief summary on the history of the trombone. The trombone is a 15th century development of the trumpet, introduced in Burgundy. During the Renaissance, it was referred to as a sackbut. Towns and courts both sponsored bands of sackbuts, the most influential served the Duke of Burgundy. From its appearance in the 15th century, the sackbut was used all over Europe until its decline in the mid-late 17th century. Trombonists in German city-states were employed as civil officials, standing watch in city towers and announcing the arrivals of important figures to the cities, similar to the role of a military bugler. More skilled trombonists played in alto capello wind ensembles and some of the first orchestral ensembles, mainly in religious settings such as the Basilica of St. Mark in Venice during the early 17th century. During this period, some composers that wrote for trombone and sackbut include Claudio Monteverdi, Heinrich Schütz, and Giovanni Fabriello. In the 18th century, Italian music was very influential. Because so, when the sackbut began to turn to England for common use once again, it was renamed the trombone. Late Baroque period composers that wrote for trombones include Bach and Handel. Bach used it in some of his cantatas, and Handel used it in his Death March. The first major composer to use the trombone in an opera overture was Christoph Gluck and his Alcesta, written in 1767. During this time period, the trombone went through some minor appearance changes, such as a slightly more flared bell. The composer accredited for bringing the trombone into the 70s setting during the classical period is Ludwig van Beethoven, and his Symphony No. 5 died in 1808. However, certain accounts also say that the trombone was introduced into the symphony orchestra about a year earlier by Swedish composer Joachim Eggert in the Symphony in B-flat. At the turn of the 19th century, trombones became included in works by Mendelssohn, Berlioz, Liszt, Schubert, Schumann, Verdi, and Wagner. Trombonists became less employed by cathedrals and court orchestras. Now they were expected to provide their own instrument, while military musicians were provided with instruments. Orchestral musicians adopted the trombone with the widest range that they could easily apply to any of the three trombone parts that typically appeared in scores, the tenor trombone. Experiments with the trombone section included the addition of a contrabass trombone in Richard Wagner's Der Ring, Das Nibelungen, and Mahler's and Strauss's augmentation by adding a second bass trombone to the typical trio of two tenor trombones and one bass trombone. The majority of orchestral works are still scored for the usual mid to late 19th century low brass section, two tenor trombones, one bass trombone, and a tuba. Significant 20th century composers that helped the trombone maintain its importance in the orchestra setting include Bela Bartok, Leonard Bernstein, Aaron Copland, George Gershwin, Gustav Holst, Gustav Mahler, Sergei Prokofiev, Sergei Rachmaninoff, Arnold Schoenberg, Dmitri Shostakovich, Igor Stravinsky, and Ray Vaughan Williams. Due to the rise of recorded music in music schools, orchestral trombone sections all around the world began to have a more consistent idea of a standard trombone sound. During the first half of the century, community concert bands and touring bands lost their popularity and significance in the United States and faced a great decline in numbers. However, with the development of music education in the public school system, high school bands, university concert bands, and marching bands became prevalent in the U.S. Around this time, trombones joined the jazz band scene. In the swing era of the mid-1920s, the trombone became a popular solo instrument in jazz ensembles. Today, the trombone can be found in many various ensembles and music genres, from the symphony to chamber music to jazz and even R&B and hip-hop. So as you can see here, the difference between the sackbut and the trombone can be seen in the size of the bell and the addition of a water key and counterweight. Trombones come in many different shapes and sizes in our modern day, which brings us to our next topic, the specifics of the trombone. Trombones come in many different forms, the most popular being the tenor trombone, followed by the bass trombone. The complex series of tapers throughout the trombone, the smallest at the mouthpiece and the largest just before the bell, affect the intonation of the instrument. The most distinctive feature of the trombone is the slide, which allows the player to extend the length of the ear column, therefore lowering the pitch. During the Renaissance, additional sleeves or stockings were developed to prevent friction from slowing down the action of the slide. Today's can be seen on the end of the interior slide as a fractional widening of the tube. I bet adjustment of intonation can be attained by using the tuning slides at the rear part of the instrument. Trombone parts are notated in concert pitch and written in bass clef and tenor clef. Many experienced trombonists and challenging repertoire represent the use of the alto clef and the treble clef as well, since many experienced players have a wider range. With the slide drawn all the way in, the notes of the harmonic series of the B-flat below the bass staff are available. B-flat is the trombone's fundamental note, widely used for tuning instrument. The most popular trombone used in the orchestra setting is the B-flat F-tenor trombone. These trombones include an attached valve that allows the lowering of the pitch by a fourth by adding extra tuning to the instrument. It is activated by pressing down the valve with the thumb. This makes it easy for the player to reach notes that would normally be played in 6th and 7th position, such as C and D on the bass staff. On a B-flat F trombone, C can be played in 1st position with the valve held down, and B can be played in 2nd position. So, on any regular trombone that does not have a valve, C is played out here, and B is played out here. And especially with younger trombonists, they don't have that arm length. So what this trombone does is allow me to play those notes closer to the center of the instrument. Another trombone popularly used in an orchestra setting is the bass trombone. Bass trombones include the same F valve that is found on tenor trombones plus another D valve that can be used either independently or simultaneously with the first valve. Bass trombones also include a few features that allow for a darker and weightier tone than the tenor trombone, such as a wider bore, a larger bell, and a larger mouthpiece. So as shown in this slide, there are a few but noticeable differences between the bass trombone and the tenor trombone. Tonight I have brought both with me, as you can see right here. So with the tenor trombone, there's a So this is the tenor trombone. As you can see here, it's an attachment valve trombone. And with me, I also have a bass trombone that has an additional D trigger right here. So there's two extra parts of tubing that go around the instrument that allow me to change the pitch of any position I'm in. A successful and significant composer of low brass music that I would like to introduce today is Donald White. Composer Donald White was born in Norwich, Pennsylvania on February 24, 1921. Before going to school to pursue his career in music, he served in World War II as a B-17 aviator. He was awarded the Air Medal and two Oak Leaf Clusters for exceptionally meritorious achievement while participating in 15 separate armored combat missions over enemy-occupied continental Europe. On his 19th mission over Germany, and France, on March 26, 1944, he was shot down bombing V-2 rocket emplacements in Pas-de-Calais in northern France. He was captured there and held in a prison camp for 13 months. Dr. White studied music education at Temple University, studied composition at the Philadelphia Conservatory of Music, and earned his master's and doctorate at the Eastman School of Music. He joined the faculty of DePauw University in Great Castle, Indiana, and was the chairman of composition and theory studies from 1948 to 1981. He spent 4 years leading the School of Music there. At DePauw, he left behind an inspiring legacy and contributed very much to the program. In 1980, he transferred to Central Washington University in Ellensburg, Washington, where he was chairman of the music department. Craig Gray, director of music at DePauw University, has the following to say about Donald White and his time spent at DePauw. Quote, "As we became friends, I learned more and more how much DePauw meant to Don and what he contributed to the university and the School of Music. In addition to serving as the director of the School of Music, he helped establish the first contemporary music festival in 1962 that brought world-renowned composers such as Aaron Copland, Howard Hanson, and Vincent Persichetti to DePauw to work with DePauw student musicians. He means a great deal to this institution and will be missed by many of us and remembered fondly." White passed away at the age of 95 on October 4, 2016, just over 3 years ago. He was best known for three pieces, all written for low brass: the lyric suite for euphonium and wind ensemble, his 1966 trombone sonata, and tetraaragon for bass trombone, two of those which I will be performing today. He also wrote and composed many works for orchestra and vocal performance. first piece by Donald White that I will analyze today is the 1966 Trombone Sonata. Sonata was written for tenor trombone, piano, accompaniment. So, the first movement of the sonata starts off quietly and sustained at a tempo of andante, around a walking pace. The intro features thematic material played by the trombone. As seen in the introduction to movement 1, the thematic material is presented as a 12-tone row. The first 12 notes you will hear in the piece will continue to be played in that order throughout the movement. These notes are A flat, F, D, C, A, E, E flat, G, E flat, B, F sharp, then D. You will hear a distinct tempo change into a semper marcato style played at forte, where you will hear this theme replayed at a faster pace, the legato. The next transition you will hear is a slight tempo change into a more legato style. Both of these transitions will be mirrored in a coda, and at the end of movement 1, you will hear the same andante legato style you heard at the beginning that eventually fades into nothingness. This movement features a wide range of about 2.5 octaves and many arpeggiated note patterns. The second movement is played at a very slow andante tempo. This movement is in song form and includes the use of impressionistic devices. Also, you will notice the use of a mute during this movement, which lowers the volume and affects the timbre of the instrument while it is being used. The beginning section starts off at piano. As soon as the movement comes out of the middle section, you will hear a transition into a bold style of playing that is represented by an increase in volume. The end section returns to piano and is played softly. This movement is played in a 3/4 meter, meaning 3/4 notes per measure, and features a slightly narrower range than the previous movement. This last movement is played with spirit at a much faster tempo than the previous two movements. It draws thematic material for movement 1 and 2 and fuses them together to form a cyclical rondo form closing movement that portrays excitement and pizzazz. Included in this movement is the use of the 3/8 time signature that pushes the music forward throughout. You will hear many dynamic changes through this piece, ranging from the quiet start all the way to the fortissimo finale. The range of this piece is similar to that of the first movement and requires advanced breath control. One of Donald White's signature rhythms can be seen throughout this movement, the double eight note pianola, which is 1, 3, 4. The sonata for trombone and piano is a work commissioned by 1968 by the National Association of College Wind and Percussion Instructors. Please join me in welcoming to the stage our pianist this evening, Mr. Yuan Kim.
Thank you.
last piece by Bono White I will be analyzing and performing today is Tetrahagon, written in 1973 for bass trombone with piano. Louis Van Haney approached Professor Donald White in 1972 about writing a multi-movement work for bass trombone and piano in memory of three renowned little brass virtuoso performers: William Bell, Henry Remington, and Dorothy Ziegler. Tetrahagon is the product of that idea. Van Haney's technical abilities, brassman knowledge, and outstanding musicianship brought him international esteem and recognition. He graduated from the Eastman School of Music in 1942, where he was taught under Henry Remington. Following graduation, he became a member of the official Army Band in D.C. After leaving the service in 1945, he studied with William Bell, the principal tutor of the New York Philharmonic, and enjoyed a brilliant career with the orchestra for 17 years. He left in 1963 to teach trombone at the Indiana University School of Music and taught there for 25 years. He passed away shortly after 1991. Movement 1 is dedicated to Mr. Louis Van Haney. This piece is played in 3/4 time, slightly faster than Andante, and slightly slower than Moderato. Piatto Pole means enjoyable. Most of the movement is played below mezzo forte, with a gradual dynamic change at the end to allow for a climactic effect. Being that this piece is for bass trombone, we're going to hear a much wider range and many low notes. The range of this movement spans 3 octaves. Movement 2 is dedicated to William Bell, referred to here as the boss. William Bell was an instrumentalist who genuinely influenced the acceptance and artistic standards of his instrument, the tuba. He performed as a principal tubist with the Susan Band, the Cincinnati Symphony, the Goldman Band, the NBC Symphony, and the New York Philharmonic. Mr. Bell joined the faculty of the Indiana University School of Music in 1961. This movement is played in scherzando, which means in a playful manner. You will hear many characteristics popular in tuba literature, such as arpeggiated phrases and staccato style. The middle section features a cadenza that is played rubato, meaning a temporary disregard of strict tempo without altering the pace of the piece. As seen here, the use of many time signatures are employed in this movement, the most common being the 4-4 plus 3-4 plus 3-4 pattern, as heard at the beginning until the cadenza and at the end of the movement. The second movement can be challenging even to the most experienced of performers, with a quick tempo and range spanning about 4 octaves. The third movement is dedicated to Henry Remington, referred to by his former students as the Chief. A revered member of the Eastman School of Music faculty for almost 50 years, Henry Remington was a self-taught and inspired trombonist and educator. He meant a lot to his former students, as described by Howard Hanson, former director emeritus of the Eastman School. He had the following to say about the Chief. Quote, "I have always been fascinated by the attempts to analyze the attributes which make a great teacher, and have come directly to the conclusion that there is no formula. A short time ago, I was talking with one of the Chief's most famous pupils, himself the solo trombone of one of the country's great symphony orchestras. I asked him the direct question, 'What makes Henry Remington a great teacher?' His answer was equally direct, 'I don't know. If I knew, I would write the definitive book on education.' I don't know either, but I can make some guesses. It is professional knowledge without pedantry, perfection without sadism, enthusiasm mixed with dedication, and above all, a belief in the supreme importance of the individual and the development of his ability. The Chief does not just teach trombone, he teaches people. There's a world of difference." The third movement is played in adagio, slowly with great expression and legato style. Much emotion is felt throughout this piece, and features a beautiful climax right before the player vocalizes the conclusion of this movement. Es ist genug so nem Herr meinen Geist. This translates to, "It is so, it is enough so, Lord, take my mind." The last movement is dedicated to the memory of Dorothy Ziegler, also known as Dottie. Miss Ziegler, a brilliant performer on both trombone and piano, was a student of the Chief at the Eastman School of Music. She performed with the National Symphony, Stokowski's All-American Youth Orchestra, and was a principal trombonist with the Hollywood Bowl and St. Louis Symphonies, this last position being held for 14 years. She was also an active professional orchestral pianist, conductor, opera coach, and music therapist. She was a member of the faculty of the University of Miami in Florida, a position she held until her death. As mentioned in movement 3 of the sonata, you can hear the double A and double hemiola many times throughout this last movement. It is played presto, which is very fast and employs advanced syncopation and requires very controlled breathing. The theme at the beginning of this movement is repeated many times in variation. You will hear many different dynamic changes throughout In Memory of Dottie. Please join me again in welcoming to the stage Mr. Kumon Candace to perform the last selection of this evening, Tetra Aragon.
Oh,